This is the sixth year that we have built the People's Budget Campaign, and the concept is to reject a business as usual budget that is prioritizing the greed of corporations or just status quo, which does not actually meet the needs of our city. And the idea of the People's Budget is to really aggressively fight for the social needs of our community. And that is so important to highlight because we are in a very wealthy city, but which is also deeply unequal. And especially when you look at the living standards and the situation that is faced by our communities of color, look at the massive gentrification, the school to prison and deportation pipeline. So there is so much oppression and racism that we need to continue to be organized against. And so the funds that we were able to win through the People's Budget Movement, through the incredible organizing of our community leaders and our community activists themselves for programs like community passageways, for corner greeters, for creative justice, that is an example of how when ordinary people get organized, we can win. And as you said, we didn't win the first time because the majority of the council, and unfortunately I'm used to this, the majority of the council first opposed it. And it was when we continued to get organized that we were able to win. So it shows that when you have a movement's voice in City Hall, like you have through my office, and when you have the movement itself building, when you get organized, when you fight, you can win. Nobody's against public safety. As a matter of fact, when you look at who are the communities that are the most impacted by problems in public safety, it is working class communities, and especially working class communities of color. And so they are not going to be against improvements in public safety. But what our communities are saying is basically exactly what academia is saying. When you look at statistical studies from sociology and economics departments around the country, you will see that the biggest positive impact for public safety and reduction in crime, reduction in all of these problems that we all agree that should be addressed, all of that comes from actually addressing the underlying causes of these problems. And the underlying causes are not that the police departments are not funded enough. It's the inequality and the problems that come with inequality and oppression and systematic oppression, the unfair discipline towards black and brown children in Seattle public schools. Those are the things that need to be addressed. What needs to be addressed is the affordable housing crisis, the fact that the African American community is facing some of the brunt of economic evictions and gentrification in our city. So we believe that the approach that the People's Budget and our communities have taken towards restorative justice programs really reflects what the data are telling us, which is address the underlying causes of the problems, which is inequality and the oppression. And just to give you also, you know, just to put the numbers in perspective, we're talking about a police department that gets the majority of the discretionary funding from the city council and from the mayor's office. And so we're talking about a police department that is funded to the tune of $409 million. That is more than 1,000, I'm saying this right, more than 1,000 times what our communities were demanding this year for restorative justice. In other words, what we demanded and what we were ultimately able to win is a fraction of what already goes to the police department. And so it's very clear in my mind that we have done the right thing. And in fact, the public testimonies today were spot on when they said that it's important what we've won, but we need to come back next year even stronger. We need to keep getting organized. These are citywide resources, but the Central District is the epicenter of the gentrification crisis that we are seeing that is especially affecting our black and brown communities. I mean, let's keep in mind, and I'm sure many of your viewers already know, the Central District was like the dividing line when we had racist redlining. So communities of color, families of color were not allowed to reside anywhere north of that line. And now we don't have the racist redlining anymore, but we do have what is effectively an economic redlining, and it ends up being a racist redlining because who are the communities that are the most disproportionately impacted by the affordable housing crisis, by the skyrocketing rents, by escalating homelessness? It's black and brown working class communities. So every dollar that we are able to fight to invest successfully in building restorative justice for affordable housing, every success that we can have for bold public policies to address the affordability crisis and push back against gentrification, that will also disproportionately impact, positively impact the central district communities. And that's why, as the District 3 Council member and elected representative, I am especially proud that we were able to win programs that we know will have a big impact. And the impact, you know, it's important to understand, in terms of dollars, it is just $522,600. As I said, that is a fraction of what the police department gets. But because these programs are so impactful, the actual impact of these programs goes well beyond the dollars that we end up investing. You know, so for every dollar of investment, we get probably hundreds of dollars worth of returns in the lives that are protected, in the young people that are given a really good, positive, healthy start for their lives. And rather than get into the destructive criminal justice system, which is really breeding injustice, rather than get into the school to prison and deportation pipeline, which is so insidious and has played such a negative role in so many of the lives of young people of color, rather than go into all that, you can have a positive direction towards arts, towards good paying jobs, and towards a constructive approach to your own life. And I really believe that building on this success next year, we should fight to expand publicly owned affordable housing, social housing, and also the Green New Deal, which are communities of color that have been fighting for. Because both those programs, one, they will need for us to win a tax on big business, because that is the only way they can be funded. But keep in mind that if we win any tax on big business, and if we are able to fund any program of social housing or Green New Deal, it will also lead to the blossoming of public sector unionized living wage jobs with apprenticeship and pre-apprenticeship programs with priority hire. So there is so much potential for us to win more gains for the Central District and for the South End. And I'm really optimistic that, you know, on the basis of this victory, we can build for more.